And I have a new hero, I gotta tell you right that. Theo Fleury, is that how you say it?
Theo Fleury.
That was close enough, and I like this kid, I'll tell you.
He was the smallest man in the NHL.
5'5", 150 pounds.
With toughness and talent, he made himself a superstar.
Theo Fleury puts the lights out.
His dramatics on the ice, matched only by an extraordinary gift for self-destruction. Tonight, the story of a man who had it all, then lost it, but who finally may have found himself.
They should get him out of there. Yeah. Somebody in the Rangers has got
to
get
over there. It's like the meeting I went to when I was in treatment. Guy got up there, he had 16 years of sobriety. Said 7 words. You're only as sick as your secrets. And to me, that was one of those aha moments. And when I heard that statement, I started telling people my secrets.
It started more than 2 decades ago when 20-year-old Theo Fleury first arrived in Calgary for what was to become a legendary National Hockey League career in more ways than one. Good evening, I'm Bob McEwen. Welcome to the Fifth Estate. It could have been a classic Canadian success story, the diminutive kid from the prairies who made it all the way to the top. But Theo Fleury will always be remembered for something else as well, his personal demons and the staggering fall from grace that cost him millions of dollars, his family, and almost his life.
In his new book, Playing with Fire, Fleury's story begins at what could well have been the end, the night he bought a handgun and a single bullet.
Like I said, I'd given up, you know, given up all hope. You know, I'd completely isolated myself.
He was alone in his house, suspended by the NHL, left by loved ones, self-medicating with vodka and cocaine.
I just wanted help. I just wanted out of the insanity. And I didn't know how to get there. I really didn't.
It was all so far from where Theo Fleury got his start. The Manitoba farming community of Russell, population 1,700, known for its main street arches and for the most famous graduate of the local hockey rink.
It's the greatest place you could ever grow up as a kid. You know, unlimited ice time. We always met at the rink and threw the sticks in the middle and played 25 on 25, you know. And I think that's the biggest reason why my raw skill developed into the skill that it was, because you try to beat 25 guys on the ice and make passes through guys' skates and sticks and whatnot. I think, you know, that was probably the biggest reason why I was so much more talented than everybody else.
And from his first time on skates, Theo Fleury says he had no doubt.
From the time I was 6 years old, I knew that I was going to be an NHL player and that there was nothing or no one that was going to stop me.
Oh, just he was a great player, and he was, and firecracker, and always played with an attitude, even, you know, when he was 8 years old.
The boys just have to concentrate on hockey and concentrate on playing well.
Sheldon Kennedy grew up nearby. He, too, destined for the NHL.
You know, Sheldon and I, we had a few battles. He played in Elkhorn, and I was from Russell, and we were probably the two best teams in the area.
For each, hockey was a refuge from the hard life at home where both of their fathers drank.
I loved it because, you know, if you look at my home life, you know, there wasn't too many good things going on there. So when I was at the rink, I got admiration, I got attention, I got everything I needed at the rink.
Barely teenagers, Fleury and Kennedy would soon get what seemed to be their big break, catching the eye of Manitoba Junior League scout and coach, Graham James.
Well, I would hope to think that, you know, first and foremost, I was a great hockey player. That's what, you know, initially drew him to me, because he was a scout, right? And he had a job, and he was, you know, getting paid to find guys like me.
Fleury signed on with James and his Winnipeg Warriors, at first flattered by all the attention from his coach.
Over the years, there were rumors and whispers about the relationship between the young Theo Fleury and the now infamous hockey coach Graham James. It's a story that Fleury kept a deep, dark secret until now.
It started with an invitation. James asked the 14-year-old Fleury and two teammates on a road trip. They stayed at a Super 8 motel in North Dakota. James and Fleury shared a bed. In his book, he says he woke up at 2 a.m., the room blacked out, to find Graham James molesting him.
And, you know, it was like, it's very confusing, you know? You're so afraid that, you know, if I tell somebody, what's gonna happen to my hockey career? You know what I mean? Because I was so focused on, you know, getting out of Russell, you know? I was so focused on that, that I was probably willing to do whatever it took to, you know, to make it.
He says what followed in the next few years were hundreds of incidents, fondling, masturbation, oral sex.
Who could I tell? You know what I mean? I couldn't tell my parents. They were in their own, you know, stuff, you know? And that's, you know, essentially I think that's the power of this whole thing is that, you know, the person knows that you're not gonna say anything.
When Graham James and the Warriors moved to Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, Sheldon Kennedy joined the team. The coach took a special interest in him too.
This would have been going on with Graham James on both your parts at the same time, essentially, but you would not have known it?
Oh, we knew it. Oh, I knew it. Theron had to go to Graham's Wednesdays and Mondays and Wednesdays, I think, and I had to go Tuesdays and Thursdays. And we'd pass each other in the hallway sometimes.
Did you ever talk about it together?
No. I don't think... That's one of those things where I don't think you had to talk about it. You knew what was going on, and that was it.
But at one point, James invited both of them on another road trip to Disneyland. As usual, they shared motel rooms, James alternating nights in each boy's bed. Fleury says when it was his night, he did his best to send his mind somewhere far away.
We would take turns, you know, sharing, you know, the bed with him on different nights. You know, I didn't see, you know, what was going on with him. I was only concerned about what was going on with me and, you know, trying to find an escape exit somehow, some way.
And when it wasn't his turn, he trained himself to fall fast asleep.
Because when you're with him, you never got any sleep, you know? He never got any sleep, you know? He was on you all the time.
Sheldon Kennedy wasn't so fortunate. One way or the other, kept awake almost all night, every night, by Graham James.
I was awake. I don't know if I slept much for my teenage years. And I could see, and it just, you know, I knew what was going on, so.
On the drive back from Disneyland, he recalls being abused by James in the front seat while Fleury dozed in the back.
Talk about trapped. It almost felt like you were kidnapped. In a way, you probably were.
The next season, Graham James lost his job in Moose Jaw, and Theo Fleury dared to hope he'd finally seen the last of him. Again, Sheldon Kennedy wasn't so lucky. When James got a new job with the Swift Current Broncos, he traded for Kennedy, and the abuse continued. But outwardly, Graham James seemed a model coach, winning the national championship in 1989, named the Hockey News Man of the Year.
You know, I got hit my very first shift on the ice, and you know that.
Meanwhile, Theo Fleury was trying to bury his secrets and further his hockey career.
Between Canada and the Soviets, number 10 in the white uniform is Theron Fleury.
He is not at 5'5" and 150 pounds. He was fearless, captain of the Canadian junior team and a legendary Donnybrook with the Russians at the World Championships. He's been one
of the best players. Here's the scene that was started by Wayne and the
with Calgary in his rookie NHL season. He helped the Flames win the Stanley Cup.
This is the greatest day of my life, greatest day for my family. I love everybody in Canada. This is the greatest feeling. We're number one, and they can't take that away from us.
This is crazy. You know, this is crazy. Like, I couldn't have written it up any better.
Messier gives it away. Here's Fleury looking for his first goal of the series. Scores! And Theron Fleury and the Flames are in seventh heaven.
Before long, Theo Fleury seemed to be on top of the world. Columnist and hockey writer Eric Francis.
He was a superstar, no doubt about it. I mean, I would put him in an elite category where, you know, I think the ultimate tribute you can have as a player is when you come to town and you know that everyone in the crowd is going to see you and boo you because they knew he was dangerous as a player, but also frustrating and irritating as an opponent because he wasn't just a superstar, he was also a super pest.
It was a time when alcohol was an integral part of NHL life, and Fleury took full advantage, partying almost every night, trying to keep his secrets buried.
You know, obviously I was the toast of the town, but, you know, I look back on it and, you know, the disease had such a hold of me and, you know, the pain.
Even for Calgary's favorite son, an NHL superstar, it was also very deep and raw, which is why when the allegations of sexual abuse against Graham James became public, Theo Fleury began to panic.
I thought this was buried. I thought this was over. And then it all came back, you know? And with it, a whole new behavior. Cocaine, vodka, man, that's my magic elixir, or was my magic elixir, you know? That made all the pain go away. I was happy, you know, fun guy to be around, you know. That's the only way I could deal with it at the time.
Kennedy got crossed up and a break for the Flames. Hit on goal. Kennedy scores!
When we come back, his childhood pal and NHL teammate Sheldon Kennedy goes public as no hockey player ever had before. By the mid-90s, Theo Fleury was an NHL superstar, captain of the Calgary Flames, and the face of the franchise.
His coordination was exceptional. He could tip pucks out of the air. He could do a lot of things a lot of players couldn't do that were much bigger, and he wasn't afraid of anyone. He would fight, hit, yap at everybody.
Glenn Sather ran the Flames' arch rivals, the Edmonton Oilers.
You know, he had a real aggressive attitude about the things that he did. And I always liked cocky guys, so I admired him for that.
Janney will try. Janney got crossed up and a break for the Flames. Hit on goal. Kennedy scores!
And Fleury's friend Sheldon Kennedy had made it to the big time, too, also with the Flames. But both were still struggling with the abusive, sometimes bizarre behavior of Graham James and the demons left behind. Especially alcoholism.
I didn't have any tools. No tools at all to be able to deal with what I was going through at the time. And, you know, every time I was alone, that was a scary time. And that's why I acted out the way that I did. You know, the drugs and alcohol masked the emotional pain.
He had separated from Shannon, the mother of his first child, Josh. Then he met Veronica, who had become his first wife. They'd have a son and daughter. But Fleury's dalliances were legion.
You have girls throwing themselves at you, and it feeds your ego, you know? What's the saying? We're egomaniacs with inferiority complexes.
But whatever his mental state, it didn't help that Graham James had stayed in contact, as if nothing had happened between them. One day, he phoned Fleury with an idea.
Theron Fleury, who's arguably the most popular athlete in Calgary. Maybe
James asked him to become a partner in a new junior hockey team in Calgary, the Hitmen. James would be the coach.
He calls you. You've gone on. You're a star. He calls you to invest in the Calgary Hitmen.
Mm.
You don't hang up the phone. You give him, what, six figures?
Let's see, I think I invested like $125,000. But you know what? I knew he would not stop calling me, you know? He would have called me, and it was the same thing. He would just not stop, you know? And yeah, I look back on that, you know. But I guess that's the power of the abuse at the time.
And Sheldon Kennedy gave $1,000 to James too. But now, his former coach's presence in Calgary and proximity to more young hockey players brought back all the abuse.
Well, my wife was pregnant with our daughter, and I knew I wasn't going to be the dad that I wanted to be. And I remember seeing Graham outside the locker room with all these Hitman kids. I just knew that he was doing it. I knew what was going on, and I think I tried to reach out to adults, and nobody was going to do anything.
Kennedy knew he had to go to the police for the kids and himself.
I needed to do something because I couldn't. I was going to die. Bottom line, I needed to start that process, and that was for sure. You know, well, that was probably the toughest decision I've ever had to make.
When Graham James' name became public during the police investigation, many in Calgary refused to accept the accusations. Eric Francis of the Calgary Sun was one of them. In his column, at least at first, he defended James.
Before charges are laid, let's just let the court system decide and figure this whole thing out. Let's not all rush to judgment, because this guy did a lot of great things for hockey over the years.
Like others, eventually he realized he was wrong.
In retrospect, he'd done a lot of horrible things for hockey and a lot of horrible things to innocent little boys.
Most outstanding graduate.
After trying to bury the past, now incredibly in business with his abuser, on the inside, Theo Fleury was seething.
What's going through my mind is that, holy cow, I'm going to have to deal with this again, you know? And, you know, I think as soon as Sheldon came out, I think everybody knew that I was one of the guys as well, right? But, you know, my behavior after that was, you know, typical of somebody who's scared and, you know, alone again. You know, the pain came rushing back. Mm-hmm.
You're certainly the star of the team. Did it occur to you that you could come forward, that you could support Sheldon, and that you could tell to be known about Graham James?
I could have done a lot of things. But was I ready? Absolutely no way was I ready. As a human being, do I have the right to deal with it whatever way I want to? Absolutely. But I sort of know how kind of Sheldon was feeling, you know.
Well,
I know how I was feeling. I was scared. I was very scared.
So Theo Fleury kept his secrets to himself, even after Graham James pleaded guilty to 350 counts of sexual abuse.
When he was convicted, 350 counts, what went through your mind?
Well, I didn't realize it was that extreme.
What would it have been if it included you?
I don't know. Double it, 700. And, you know, he probably would have spent a little bit more time in jail.
Through it all, Fleury remained an NHL superstar. But by now, he had also developed an insatiable appetite for cocaine.
There was nothing for the pain. So that's why I tried different things, you know? The alcohol was working for a while, you know? And then you add the cocaine in there, and I was like, not feeling anything.
But in your case, you're staying up till 7 in the morning, you're going to practice.
Well, I
I can tell you, I was skating around practice going, you know what, today might be the day, man, where the heart just blows up, you know? You know. And I think whether I wanted to admit it or not, I was, you know, some way, somehow trying to, you know, kill myself.
The clock was now counting down in a number of ways. Fleury's wild lifestyle and his looming free agency would soon prove too much for the Calgary Flames.
No, I'm gonna miss it here, for sure.
Theo Fleury was traded.
Obviously, I have some abandonment issues, right? So when I got traded from Calgary, that's what it felt like, yeah. You know?
Do you think they did that because they thought you were a ticking bomb in a way?
Yeah, they were protecting, you know, it's a business.
When we come back, Theo takes Manhattan, but his big payday would turn out to be the beginning of the end.
I told him that he couldn't play here if he could play for free. I didn't want anything to do with him.
Since he was 16, addiction had been Theo Fleury's way of life. First, alcoholism, triggered by years of abuse by Graham James. Then, cocaine, to mask the fear of public disclosure. And to compound it all, he was traded away from the security of his hockey home, Calgary.
And I thought I was going to end my career in Calgary, but, you know, it wasn't in the cards. You know, after that, I was, you know, was completely lost, you know. And then you throw money in there and, you know, because I was trying to get some power back, I figured out that money was power and you know, I can control people with money and you know, women and all that kind of stuff. Like, that was like tailor-made.
After 10 years, Theo Fleury was finally a free agent, able to test his worth in the NHL marketplace. The New York Rangers were willing to pay top price, 4 years, $28 million. The question was, even if the Rangers' offer was best, was New York really the best place for someone like Theo Fleury?
His family ensconced in suburbia, he spent much of his time in Manhattan, where even a star hockey player could be anonymous.
When I left the rink, I didn't know who I was. You know, the bars, the drugs, the, you know, hanging out with homeless people, and, you know, maybe that's who I thought I was, or maybe that's how I felt. I don't know.
At home and on the road, Fleury frequented strip clubs, one-stop shopping, booze, drugs, women. After one notorious night in Atlanta, his wife found a $36,000 charge on the family credit card. Car wash was what it said.
$30,000 I spent one night.
How do you spend $30,000 in a night at the Gold Club in Atlanta?
It's pretty easy, you know. You get 15 girls in a room, you pay them, you know, $1,500 an hour. You order some champagne, you know, you pay the bouncers off, you get them to bring you some party favors, and there you go, $30,000. Pretty simple.
Even if you're making $7 million a year, it strikes me that that would put a pretty big hole in your take-home pay.
But like I said, man, that's the insanity of this whole disease. You don't care. You really don't care.
After his first season in New York, Fleury got a new boss when the Rangers hired veteran executive Glenn Sather. He'd heard plenty of rumors about his new star's lifestyle, but no proof.
There was no testing for anything, and you had to be absolutely 100% sure that if you were going to accuse somebody of doing drugs or alcohol or being an alcoholic, that you had to know exactly what was going on. And
Sather called Fleury to a meeting at Madison Square Garden.
You tell him that you know about his background with Graham James. You know that that's likely the root of a lot of his problems.
I thought that those were the root. You know, that's where all his problems were really coming from. It was probably what happened to him when he was young and abused. He wasn't really eager to talk about the Graham James situation. He was eager enough to talk about, you know, the alcohol and that he was really being careful and taking care of himself. And of course, I really never believed any of that.
Under Sather, Fleury was more like his old self on the ice, the Rangers' leading scorer. But away from the rink, he was his old self again, too.
Obviously, he caught up to me at the end, but for a long time, I was able to, you know, to still somewhat get the job done, I guess, you know. My first AA sponsor told me one time that he used to have a saying, and it was, "It hasn't gotten weird enough for me yet." And that's what it was like.
Let me just play the devil's advocate here. Mm-hmm. And there's some room to do that.
Mm-hmm.
You're making $7 million a year. You're married. You're a father.
Mm-hmm.
You're a mature adult. Is there not some role here for individual choice, for responsibility?
Yeah, absolutely. Was I there in my life? Nope. Did I hurt a lot of people because of it? Absolutely. Have I tried to apologize to those people? As much as I can.
When the NHL could no longer ignore all the reports of all his addictions, Fleury was summoned by the league's substance abuse program.
And it was like I wasn't hiding it, really. You know what I mean? Show up to practice, you know, wasted and, you know, smell, you know. So, and it was almost like I was reaching out, you know, because I knew I was going down.
Fleury entered the NHL program. And that summer, he returned from rehab for the first time in years, clean and sober.
I'm sitting at home one day and the phone rings. And it's like, this Theo there speaking. He goes, "Hey, it's Wayne." I'm like, "Wayne who?" He says, "Wayne Gretzky." I'm like,
Gretzky had been chosen to run Canada's Olympic hockey team.
"We would really like to see you at the orientation camp." And I was like, wow, you know.
Did that surprise you?
Yeah, it did.
Why?
Well, you know, that I guess that they thought enough about me that they would include me in this.
Now, Theo Fleury had three compelling reasons to clean up his act. Glenn Sather looking over his shoulder, the NHL substance abuse program doing drug tests, and Wayne Gretzky's invitation to play for Canada at the Olympics. Even so, for an addictive personality like Fleury's, it was going to be a challenge.
You know, that snapped me in, you know, for however long I needed to, you know, keep it together, right? You know, I wasn't drinking, but I was, you know, I was gambling quite a bit.
Now, after practice, Fleury commuted by limo to the Mohegan Sun Casino in Connecticut. Some days he won. On others, he lost as much as $150,000.
I've gone through every addiction there is, you know, food, sex, gambling, drugs, booze, spending money.
On the straight and narrow, for the time being, Fleury played at the Olympics in Salt Lake and won gold. In retrospect, it would be the peak of his hockey career.
You know, and I'm probably most happy for Theo Fleury. There's so much controversy about him being on the team, but as you know, being here game in, game out, he was one of our best players.
I think probably after I won the gold medal, I probably should have retired. What more did I have to prove, or what else could I have won? Yeah, another Stanley Cup.
But the end of the Olympics opened the floodgates again. Old patterns of behavior pouring out, drinking, drugs, womanizing, gambling, all, of course, to excess. Fleury holed up in the Tony W. Hotel on Times Square, begin a three-week binge he estimates cost him about $200,000.
Doesn't anybody know about this?
I don't know. I'm sure they did. You know, I'm sure they did. But I think, I might have been leading the NHL in scoring at the time, or close to it, you know?
And how somebody could keep that away from us was almost mystifying to me, and he had been pretty successful at doing that.
He couldn't hide it forever, though he tried, at one point using his baby son's urine for a drug test. But eventually he was found out and again forced to enter the NHL substance abuse program. By now it was all too much for the New York Rangers. Though Fleury offered to take a pay cut, Glenn Sather refused to pick up his option.
I told him that he couldn't play here if he would play for free. I didn't want anything to do with him. I liked Theo as a guy, but I just didn't want his influence on the team. It was too risky.
There are no guarantees.
Signed by Chicago, his season ended with a brawl in a Columbus, Ohio strip club that left his face bruised and swollen. NHL Commissioner Gary Bettman suspended Fleury. That was 6 years ago. Which brings us back to that handgun and the bullet that Fleury bought. When we return, his darkest moment.
But the gun was like, that is the most powerful thing that I've ever had in my hand.
And how almost miraculously it led to this.
I just wanted out of the insanity. And I didn't know how to get there. I really didn't.
He'd purchased the gun that afternoon and had thrown in a bullet. Why he had bought it, he wasn't sure. But Theo Fleury knew one thing. He couldn't go on the way he was.
Yeah, God knows how much cocaine I'd done, how many, you know, bottles of vodka I'd been through, you know? And just thought at that time it might be a good time to shut her down.
Once again, things went from bad to worse. Fleury put the bullet in the gun. He put the gun in his mouth.
I think I was trying to kill the demon inside. Because I knew who I was. Like, I knew that I'm a good person. I knew that, like, I knew all that. But the gun was like, that is the most powerful thing that I've ever had in my hand, you know? That I was gonna be able to just pull the trigger and that was it, be over. And you know what, I was too chicken. I wasn't, you know, I couldn't do it. It was all right there. You know, I had it in my mouth, but you know, something clicked, I don't know. And I just threw it away.
What? Everything that's in your body that you want to get rid of, these rocks here will take it all. Yeah.
That was when things finally started to change. And Theo Fleury began looking in an unusual direction, ahead.
You know, I could have died or I could have lived. And I chose to live.
I was drinking. I was partying. I mean, I'm not perfect.
It didn't happen overnight, but when he met and married Jennifer, they began to get sober together. They've since had a baby girl. Fleury is part Cree. They both say native traditions like this sweat lodge have helped to purge their demons.
I mean, we were both in probably very dark places, and I think we saved each other. It was, you know, it was the best thing that could happen to us. And we drank for several months together.
In all, Theo Fleury earned more than $40 million from hockey, most of it long gone. But he says he's found something far more important.
It doesn't sting anymore, you know? You know, I look at it in a spiritual way as more than anything else, that, you know what, there's a reason why it happened to me. And when I asked God for help to overcome this, he allowed me to frame it in a different way, and he obviously thinks that I can help a lot of people, you know, by telling this story. Go around a
Fleury has spent the past few years healing and apologizing.
He called me once just right out of the blue and said that part of his 10-step program with Alcoholic Anonymous is that he had to confess and make up with the people that he'd hurt. And he called me and apologized for the things that had happened, and he was genuine, sincere, and I wished him well and thanked him for the call.
Just put your towel on, this is wet.
Here you are today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Damn proud of it, you know? Because I've been to hell and back, literally. And, you know, thank God I still have people that still love me, you know, even after all that stuff that they had to go through, you know? And that's why I said forgiveness is just the greatest gift that I've been given, you know?
Could you forgive Graham James?
No. You know, that's on a different level. Because I don't think there's any love in that man's vocabulary. You know, he doesn't think like normal people think. Now, when I think about Graham James, I think about a little boy that's by himself. And I go, the big Theo, go gets the little Theo and grabs him by the hand, and we walk out of that room together. Because that's what I wanted. I wanted somebody to come and take that little guy out of there. And you know what? There's no better guy to do it than me.
It had been 6 years since Theo Fleury last touched NHL ice. In hockey circles, he was washed up, all but forgotten.
For a guy that loved to play hockey as much as I did, you know, the disease won. You know, it beat me. And it took something away that I loved more than life itself.
But Fleury has never been one to accept defeat. This past summer, against all odds, there he was, reinstated by the NHL, back in the uniform of the Calgary Flames.
What was the point at which you decided at the age of 40 or 41 you wanted to give it another try?
It was when I truly surrendered and just wanted to prove it to myself, nobody else, you know? Because when you got a gun in your mouth, you're going, you know, where is that guy? Guy with the gun's giving up. He's quitting, he's packing it in, you know? And then for quite a long time, you know, I had been able to overcome and defeat and all those things so many times. I was questioning myself if I had that still inside of me.
Theo, I read, and you correct me if I'm wrong, but is Friday the 4 years
exactly? Tomorrow is 4 years to the day, so it's kind of ironic, yeah.
That's quite the week, right? I mean,
he'd been sober for 4 years, hadn't played in the NHL in six, but the Flames' first preseason game could have been a time warp.
Well, the electricity in that building it was emotional for everybody. I mean, I look around me and everybody was crying with tissues. It wasn't just me, you know. It was tears of joy and excitement. And the people in Calgary, they truly love him and admire him. And I think that they honestly feel like they know him and are connected to him.
The game was tied to be decided by a shootout. The final shooter, you guessed it.
I wish he had have made it. But for him to be as determined as that, to get to that stage, you have to admire him, because he's put in a lot of effort to get there. And he's put in a lot of effort to get his demons salted away, so I just hope that he's done it.
He'd captured the hearts and minds of Canadians again. But in the end, the Flames released him, and Theo Fleury announced his retirement.
You know, I don't look at this as a retirement. I look at it as, you know, the first part of my life is over. And, you know, now the real thing starts, and we're gonna fire up the karaoke downstairs.
What a long, strange trip it's been. But now, he says, the friends and family who've stuck by him will be his teammates each and every new day, like his next big game. When he was convicted of sexual abuse in 1997, Graham James was sentenced to 3.5 years in prison. Police have recently indicated they would undertake another investigation of James if Theo Fleury files a complaint. Sheldon Kennedy has urged his old friend to do just that. We'll be right back.